This morning, would you thank Angelique and Tony for coming all the way? Blessed me.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen. So this morning, let's do a little review. How many of you love history? I've seen that my wife is going to tell the truth. She doesn't. Let's do a little bit of historical review. A little over a year ago, you as a church voted at 90-some% to ask me to come as your bivocational pastor. Now, what does that mean? What does bivocational pastor mean? That means I have another job besides this one. Which is care for pastors, and most of you know a little bit about that. We'll talk a little bit more about it this morning. You also acknowledged that in order to survive, there would have to be some things take place. Change. How many of you? Some of you have nightmares about this book. The autopsy of a deceased church. I thought that thing was dead and gone. This is a review, folks, okay, of where we were. By your own diagnosis, you said our church is a dying church. And if we are to get off from the ventilator, the spiritual ventilator, before we die, there's some things that have to happen. And this is what Tom Rainer said that would have to happen. The church must admit and confess its dire need. Which we did. Most churches move toward death because they refuse to acknowledge their condition. We become nose blind, like we've been talking about in the nursery to preschool children. Well, but we've acknowledged our dire need. Number two, the church must pray for wisdom and strength to do whatever is necessary. You made that commitment. You said, Pastor, what is necessary? We didn't know then. We know a little bit more now, and we'll know more in the future. The church must be willing to change radically. Adam Rainer, who deals with churches, Tom Rainer, who deals with churches all over the nation, says this. Usually, this is the point of greatest resistance. The church must be willing to change radically. You said we cannot continue doing what we're doing and expect any other different results. Okay? So, and then number four, the change must lead to action and an outward focus. We've seen that happening. Not that it wasn't happening before, but now a more concentrated effort with trunk or treat, with Montbird and Montbird Day and everything like that, as well as other outreaches. When a church begins to act positively with this radical change, it has essentially become a new church. Just because we are no longer First Baptist Montbird, but we are Embrace Church at Montbird, that doesn't automatically mean that we've changed. It'll be a change of heart. Now, can anyone here today give me one good reason why a church that by its own self-diagnosis, a dying church, can't become healthy enough to reach Montbird and her surrounding community? One good reason. Well, I'll give you one. People not willing to believe it can happen. We're a little over a year into this relaunch process. The only thing that will be that will be the greatest impediment is people who don't believe it can happen. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. Now faith is being hopeful. out to Jeff Posey, if you're with me this morning. Now, faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. That's faith. Faith is being sure of what we hope for, and that's not a, that is a certainty, not an if. A certainty of what we do not see. So the next few weeks, our focus is simply going to be, I'm in. Get your bulletin. I'm in. Okay, we can pray go home. Right? No. I'm in. Now, I knew what that meant, but I went ahead and looked up the definition of what does it mean, I'm in. It's count me in, I want to be included. If you all have a party or something, and you decided to order pizza, usually college students, they would say, okay, let's order pizza. And everybody should say, I'm in. Count me in. Well, this morning, and as we look forward over the next few weeks, it's not just I'm in. It's I'm all in.
All means all in. That's all means.
You get it? I'm all in. Now, many of you a year and a half ago publicly said, I'm in. Well, again, we're doing a review. We're seeing where we are right now. Okay. So before you answer that you're in, there are some things to consider. Before you say, hey, I'm in on that property deal. Well, what's it going to cost me? What's it going to cost me? I'm all in on the pizza. Well, but what's it going to cost me? What's my part? So before we give our answer this morning, then let's think about this. First of all, count the cost. Count the cost. I'm in, but what is it going to cost me? The cost of being in on God's work calls for steps of faith. Not one step of faith, but multiple steps of faith. If we would go through the Hebrews 11 hall of faith, you would see that with most of those men and women, it wasn't one step of faith, but it was multiple steps of faith, each one built upon the other. It usually involves an element of fear. I'm not going to tell you faith doesn't come with fear. But I will tell you this, as the song says, fear is a liar. Fear is a liar. With Moses says, you know, I'm inadequate. So there's usually fear and there's usually feelings of inadequacy. Moses said, I can't talk real clear. I'm slow of tongue. God says, that's okay. I'll let Aaron speak for you. Okay. No excuses. It may be a fear of failure that people will say, well, I'm not in. You remember when Moses sent the 12 spies over into the promised land, that brought them right up to the edge of the promised land, sent 12 spies in, and they spied out the country. 10 of them came back and they said, it is a wonderful land. It is a land flowing with milk and honey, but there are giants in the land. There are huge walled cities. We can't do this. We're too few in number. Joshua and Caleb said, yes, we can. Yes, we can. But so typically, when we're thinking about all in, there is that fear of failure. But here's the thing. God has a proven record throughout the centuries of asking ordinary people to take steps of extraordinary faith. Some might say about Embrace Church, well, we're so small. What can we do? Do I need to remind you of how small a stone took out a giant? David said, bring it on. Do you remember what Jesus said, that if you had faith the size of a mustard seed, and we know a mustard seed is big. You can hardly see it, tiny. He says, if you have enough, if you have seed the size of a mustard seed, you can say, well, mountain be moved. We said, well, Pastor, I haven't seen any mountain move lately. Well, think about it. Think about it. Again, God has a proven record throughout the centuries of asking ordinary people. People who take steps of extraordinary faith, resulting in what only God can do. You remember the story of Gideon? God called Gideon when he was down in a well threshing wheat. Okay. Throwing it up, the chaff blowing it, falling back down there. And the angel says, hey, almighty man of valor. And God calls Gideon up, calls out an army. But too many show up. It's too many. Too many. If you go to war with this many Gideon, then you're going to get the glory. So God pares them down. Till it seems like it's an impossible amount of people given the almost impossible task. And God says, this is good. Because now I'll get the glory. Now I'll get the honor. Now you will get to be used as a small army to accomplish a great task. Could that be what God wants to do here? I believe so. But there's a cost. So you said, okay, Pastor Ron, what is the cost? In Hebrews 11, it lists those individual risk takers. Those individuals who by faith were sure that what they hoped for and they were certain for what they couldn't see. There was Abel. And there was Noah. How would you like the task of building a boat big enough to hold two of all the animals and seven of all the unclean animals in the world? And God says, I'm going to destroy the earth with water. And it had never rained up to that point. You said, never rained? Check it out. Yeah. Check it. You talk about faith. Talk about ridicule. Can you imagine all those years that Noah and his three sons are building this humongous ark? Have you seen the ark up in Kentucky? It's huge. Huge. Humongous. Building this ark, and people come by out of curiosity and say, well, Noah, what are you doing? I'm building a boat. What, a boat for what? What's going to rain? Rain, what's that? Well, God's going to destroy the earth with what? With water. Really? Imagine the ridicule. We kept building. We kept building. You could go all the way through Hebrews chapter 11 and see what happens. So what do I see as embraces immediate count the cost? Here's what I see as our immediate count the cost. John chapter 13, 34 and 35. A new command I give you. Love one another. How? As I've loved you. So, you must love one another. And by this, all men will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. You say, Pastor Ron, are you saying that you don't believe that we love one another? I believe you do love one another, but you want to know something? We've got to love one another better. We've got to love one another better. It's by our love for one another that calls attention to the world that there's something different about us. The one thing in the New Testament that makes clear is that we are to love one another. Jesus says, love one another is the very thing that will attract the world. So love. As a matter of fact, he says this. As I have loved you, as I have loved about you love one another? See, again, the question is not do we love one another, but how can we love one another better? That needs to be the question we ask. How can we love one another better? And in 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 through 12, John takes this principle up to another level. Because this is what he says in 1 John 4, 7. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. That's pretty simple to understand, but then he goes on. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. And this is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. But if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is made complete in us. The question is not do we love each other. The question moving forward is, how can we love each other better? How can we love each other better? The next cost calls for supernatural unity. I just want to tell you, in our ministry care for pastors and their families, the greatest struggle that pastors have in churches is a lack of unity. 2 weeks ago, we get a call from a pastor who has been at a church, a very large church, for 12 years, served this church faithfully. This church faithfully. He's 63 years old. A couple of power brokers in the church decided his time was to come to an end. And they fired him. So where was the church? There wasn't enough unity in the church to stand against the clergy killers. So he was let go after 12 years of service, and they wanted to give him 3 weeks severance at 63. How about that? If we are going to love one another and love one another more, there has got to be this supernatural unity. And this is what John says about it, what Jesus says about it in John chapter 17, verse 20. My prayer is not for them alone. So Jesus is in the Garden of Gethsemane, and he says, my prayer is not for my disciples alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message. That would be me. That would be you. So Jesus is praying, not for the disciples, but he's praying for the followers that after they hear the gospel of Jesus Christ through the apostles and it spreads, he's praying for us. Verse 21. That all of them may be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. May they also be in us so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you have given me, that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I in them, and you in me. Look at this next phrase. May they be brought together to complete unity, to let the world know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. A couple weeks ago, I told you about the church that at the end of the Sunday evening service, a lady stood up and called the church to a business meeting and immediately fired the pastor, and they had a fist fight out in the foyer. Not a makeup story. True story. What does that say to the community? Why would the community want to get there? Folks, if we are going to continue to move forward, there's got to be that supernatural unity. Not focused on what I want, but what does the Father want? How can the Father knit us together with our different personalities and our different backgrounds and get rid of our personal preferences so that we can be knit together as one to reach this community with Jesus? That's why I said, before we say, I'm in, we got to count the cost. We got to count the cost. If we are serious about reaching the community, then we must be serious about pursuing unity. Because we cannot, we will not be able to reach this community for Jesus Christ if there is not oneness within this body. Not focusing on what we disagree about, but focusing on what we agree about. Let me just tell you, one of the greatest honors I've had in the last 8 years is when the Nazarene District Superintendent calls me up and says, Ron, I've got a church that's in trouble, and I'm wondering if you would be willing to come in and help them out and be an interim pastor for them. And my immediate comment to him was, well, and I gave Dr., you know, I'm Baptist. You know that there are some differences between Nazarenes and Baptists. And this is the mature statement that this district superintendent says, Ron, we agree on far more than we disagree on, and I know that will be your focus. I said, okay, count me in. Count me in. We come from different backgrounds. This is a place, I mean, look around at the different backgrounds. Tatiana, where are you from? I'm going to blank.
The Virgin Islands.
The Virgin Islands. Where else? I'm from West Virginia.
New England. New England.
I'm born in Alabama. Orlando.
You see, Orlando. But think of that. We come from different backgrounds. And we all have different preferences. We've got to be willing to lay aside those preferences and those different backgrounds and focus on what we agree on so this community can see a body of believers that is radically different backgrounds and different colors of skin and different personalities, but they are united. That's what they're looking for. That's what they're looking for. I hate to ask for it, but can I at least have one amen?
Amen.
Okay. It's lonely up here sometimes. It's just lonely up here sometimes. Philippians chapter 1, verses 27 and 28. Whatever happens, I think that whatever happens would mean all.
All means all.
Whatever happens, conduct yourself in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. And every day we are dealing with churches and pastors that are not conducting themselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. We're going to reach this community. And we're going to be all in. That's how we've got to conduct ourselves. Then whether I come and see you or only hear about you in my absence, I will know that you stand firm in spirit, contending as one man for the faith of the gospel. The gospel doesn't change, regardless of our backgrounds, regardless of our denominational backgrounds. The gospel doesn't change. The death, burial, resurrection of Jesus Christ, the one way to heaven, never changes.
All right.
Can we all agree on that?
Amen.
That's it. That's it. Stand firm in the Spirit, contending as one man for the faith of the gospel, without being frightened in any way by those who oppose you. If we're together, we don't have to fear what's going to happen outside there. The opposition in there, and there will be opposition. As we continue to move forward, we will have opposition from the outside. I just want to tell you to expect it. We haven't had any up to this point. We've had favor. We've had favor with the town mayor and the commissioners and everything. Favor. They're for us. They don't know exactly what they're for us, but they're for us. There's going to be opposition. That's why there has to be that supernatural unity. Without being frightened in any way by those who oppose you. This is a sign to them that they will be destroyed, but that you will be saved, and that is by God. What would happen if we took God's description of the church as a family seriously? What would happen if a group of people sought Jesus fervently, loved one another sacrificially, and proclaimed the gospel boldly? God only knows what could happen. God only knows what could happen when a group of people love Jesus fervently, who love each other sacrificially, and then share the gospel boldly. You say, but there's so few of us. Good! So God gets the glory. God gets the glory. Next point is this. Servanthood. Servanthood. Rebecca told me she couldn't find that word anywhere in the dictionary or whatever. But you know what it means, don't you? Servanthood. It may be a word that only exists here, but it's real. Every person that God used greatly, that has been used greatly for God, served. Hebrews chapter 11, there is no one in that chapter of faith that didn't serve. I didn't sit back and say, well, let me watch and see what's going to happen. No. They're actively involved in serving. In the capacity that they could. God never asks us to serve in capacities that we can't. He asks us to serve in the capacities that we can. Faith requires movement. Movement in obedience to God's directive. Faith isn't stagnant. Faith calls for movement. It calls for being a servant, for servanthood. And this is what Jesus said, Matthew 20, 28. Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for men. One of the problems in the American church today is it is filled with entitled people who says, okay, I'm here. What can you do for me? What can you do for me? How can you serve me? Because I'll tell you something, if you don't serve me correctly, There's another joint down the street that they will. Church, excuse me. Yeah. I'll keep searching until I get what I want. Title. Can't be about me. Jesus says, I have come not to be served, but to serve. I'm all in. I'm in. We'll call for service. I'm so thankful for the amount of this high percentage that's serving. We got to continue doing. Got to continue doing. Nehemiah. The walls of the city were in disarray. He saw what needed to be done. He came back and he shared with the people what could be done. And the Bible says the people strengthened their hands and said, let's begin the good work. And if you read the book of Nehemiah, you see that there were individuals building the wall from every background imaginable. There was one family that all the man had was a bunch of daughters, and they were out there throwing mud. But they were building them. They were doing their part. It is so easy for us to become easily satisfied. I'm in. Well, if that's the case, there's always a decision. There's always a decision. People have to say yes to God's call. Moses did. Gideon did. Abraham did. They have to be willing to say yes. There is always a changed life if you're in. Those who say yes to God's call, God doesn't call for our walk to be perfect. But because they say yes to God, they're willing to learn from their failures. God's not looking for perfection. He's looking for progress. There are some who say no, and they're changed also. Those who say no to the call of God become a little harder, a little more resistance to his call. I'm a little more likely to say no the next time that God speaks. You see, whatever the decision is, whether the decision is yes or no, it always results in a change in the life, in our lives. In January of 2011, Brunetta and I took a step of faith that had been building for over 20 years. Some of you have heard parts of this story, others of you haven't, so I just want to bring it into context. I had the privilege of leading a growing church, a church that loved us, that supported us, that ministered to us. Brunetta was leading the women's ministry, and there was nothing for them to go to the Women of Faith Conference and buy out a whole hotel. And you can imagine what kind of party they had. It was fun. But for years, God had put a vision in our heart of having a ministry that would care for pastoral families. It was a huge step of faith to leave a church that we were loved, that supported us, that were taking care of us in every way imaginable, and take a step of faith into a nonprofit ministry. And I don't think if we had stopped and thought about all that it was going to entail, but we didn't. But we took a step of faith. Believing that God was directing, sure of what we hoped for, but we sure didn't see it. Over the last 8 years, because of a step of faith, that some said that was absolutely ridiculous, my dad said, son, why in the world would you leave that church to said, I don't even understand what you're going to be doing. You're dead. I love women's ministry. Now, what am I, you know, what am I going to have to do now besides take care of you? Without knowing that there were thousands of pastors' wives out there that needed a safe place to be ministered to. Without knowing that she would have an opportunity with a team to minister to over 1,600 pastors' wives through a private Facebook account where they are ministering to each other in phenomenal ways. Literally every state except Vermont. And Canada. We had no idea. Because I don't know if you know about nonprofits, but nonprofits don't get past the offering plate every week. Y'all understand what that means? And there were times that we had to pay for things on credit card because the money wasn't there. But through it all, God has blessed in phenomenal ways that we couldn't, 8 years ago, we could not have begun to imagine. 8 years into this ministry, we have learned so much. I've learned so much about myself, about God, about the challenges that we faced in ministry and how God now uses them to minister to others. This didn't originate from me, but I'm claiming it as my own. For years in the position of a lead pastor, the pastor is looked at as kind of a hero. Now, every day, we get to help make heroes. We have to take a step of faith. It's scary. There have been times that I felt totally inadequate. We hired a firm to help us establish a plan, a business plan. And they came back, and this is pretty much what they said. We don't know, we know you've got a passion, and we know you love pastors and their families and everything, but you have no concept of systems, and we don't know if the way you can be able to exist. we don't know if you'll be able to make it. Well, just recently I had a dad that asked that consultant, so what do you think of our systems now? And he just laughed. Okay. We didn't know what we didn't know. It was a step of faith. He said, well, Pastor, why are you sharing that with us? Because I know what it's like on the other side of the mountain. I know the challenges that we as a nonprofit ministry had to go through and the fears and the apprehension that we had. But as of this week, so far this year, we have served 1,843 pastors and spouses at some level. 1,843 that we have served in some capacity, providing them a safe place. And now, in July, I'm launching the Pastor's Kids Ministry. And a step of faith. That with our research, we have found there is not another single nonprofit anywhere in the country that is offering care for the entire pastoral family, the pastor, the spouse, and the kids. That's what we get to do. That was a step of faith. And please don't hear. It was God. I had no idea. I'm not a systems guy. I don't know. All I know is the vision. I'm blessed to have an administrative wife who says, okay, you can't do that because of this. Well, okay, but can we do this? Well, yeah, you can do this. But it's together. It's together, folks. Now, faith is being sure of what we hope for, certain of what we do not see. Spirit of God, trust without borders. Wow. That's the life we're called to live. Trust without borders. From Genesis to Revelation, all throughout church history, it has been ordinary men and women just like us. It says, I believe, here is the need, here is the situation, here's what I can do, here's what we can do, and so God, we're just going to trust you. And it's those individuals that just simply trusted God that are now living beyond borders. Throughout Scripture, God calls us. Are you all in? Or are you all out? Totally different outcomes. I want to take the time to turn back to Joshua, chapter 24. Joshua had been given the task after Moses was taken to heaven of conquering the promised land, dividing down, giving all the people the inheritance. And so he's coming to the end of his life, and then he says this in Joshua chapter 24, verse 14. Now fear the Lord and serve him with all faithfulness. Throw away the gods your forefathers worshipped beyond the river and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. But if serving the Lord seems undesirable for you, then choose for yourself this day who you will serve, whether the gods of your forefathers who served beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you're now living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. And the people answered, far be it from us to forsake the Lord and serve other gods. It was the Lord our God who brought us up from us up and our fathers out of Egypt and from the land of slavery, and performed these great signs before our eyes. He protected us on our entire journey. We too will serve the Lord because he is our God. Joshua continues the context, but he picks it up in verse 23. Now then, Joshua said, throw away your foreign gods that are among you. Yield your hearts to the Lord, the God of Israel. And the people said to Joshua, we will serve the Lord, our God, and obey him. Church, is what I'm calling you to. I'm calling you a year and a half in this process. Are you in? Supernatural unity, servanthood. That's the cost. It's the cost. The joy is to live beyond borders. To see and experience God do what only God can do. As I've been preparing this series of messages, I have had to ask myself the question I'm asking you. Am I in? Am I in? Care for pastors, number one priority, but I'm in with embrace to do what I can. Are you? Let's pray. means count me in. I want to be included. And as we prepare to sing the worship song, if you're in, and you just want to remind yourself and the Lord that you're in, I would encourage you to come and make these steps an altar, freshly committing to the cost, whatever it is. Some of you may have been holding off becoming a member of this church. Be all in. You just may need to make that decision. Church, I'm committed. I'm committed. Trust without borders. So I'm not going to ask you to stand. What I am going to ask Angelique and the team to do is to go ahead and lead us in this song, and you respond in obedience to the Lord as they sing. All right. I'm in. Next week, we're going to talk about and look at the greatest I'm in Scripture. It's when Peter got out of a perfectly good boat. It is without the greatest I'm in recorded in God's Word. So for the next several weeks, we're going to focus on I'm in. Now, the month of November is the month of what? Thanksgiving. It's the month of Thanksgiving. On November the 3rd, we're going to designate that as a faith and Thanksgiving service. So what does that mean, Pastor? How many of you have yet to be to go across the way and see the nursery, preschool, and children's area? Have not been there? I want to encourage you, even if you have, there have been changes. There are now flowers blooming in the bathroom. You say, how? You just got to go see. Now they don't smell, but there are flowers blooming in the bathroom. There is more to be done. Okay? There's more to be done. Do you know how things are done that need to be done? Doesn't come free. Now, a lot of the work has been free, and we thank praise the Lord for that. But on November the 3rd, all the sermons leading up to November the 3rd are all I'm in. On that Sunday, we're going to do a special faith and Thanksgiving offering for the projects that need to be completed. Okay? The designated monies that the church and others have given have been depleted. The work is going to continue. But we need to be all in. So here is my challenge to you over the next few weeks, is for you to pray, asking God, what would you have me to be all in on this faith and Thanksgiving offering to finish the project? And Mike and Don have committed to giving me a bottom line of what needs to be done inside and out so that we're ready to invite company. I just want to tell you something. I would not care to invite anyone in the country to come and look at our nursery and preschool and children's area. It's not the biggest, but I tell you, it will compare to anywhere. I guarantee you, you won't see anything better at, what's that place down the road? It's got all the thing, real life, that place. There's nothing in real life that you would see any better than that. And we want it to continue. But folks, again, it's not just the building. God's got to transform us also. And a part of the transformation is us giving, not because we have to, but because we get to. So I know some of you are going to be traveling, and that's why I'm telling you today, November the 3rd is that faith and Thanksgiving offering. And anything that exceeds what needs to be done inside and outside is going to go for debt retirement. Amen. Of this building. Okay? So there may be something that you've been thinking, you know, I just need to sell that thing. You know, it's not doing any good. Extra money would be nice. But you know something? God, would you have me to sell this between now and November the 3rd and participate in that? I don't know what God's telling you to do. You say, preacher, you want our money. I don't want your money. God wants your heart.
Amen.
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 If anybody's got a problem with that, take it up with Mike. Or Chris. Hear our heart. Let's get in. Let's be all in. And building up to that Sunday, I'm not going to tell you the amount, but I'm praying that it will be, with this small group, Pastor, we're so small. Yeah. But I pray that with this group of people who are saying, I'm all in, God, what do I get to give to participate in this, in finishing the building and reaching this community? I'm praying it will be the largest offering that this church has ever had. I'm just going to tell you. You say, what is the largest offering? I don't know. I don't want to know. Okay. I don't want to know. All I want to know is, budget is coming up. Those of you who are responsible for certain budget items, line items, you should have gotten an email from Russ. You need to respond to that with any increases in your area of ministry, or if it remains the same, don't assume that the stewardship will know it needs to remain the same. Send him an email back, same as 2019. Otherwise, the mafia guy, Slato, is going to be knocking on your door. All right, so if you've got a budget line, and respond to that. Trunk or treat, sign up. Candy's starting to come in. We get to participate. We've been invited by the town to set up and make a huge difference there. So Candy, October the 31st, starts at 5 o'clock. Then Montverde Day, sign up sheet back here. We need to start planning and preparing for that, bringing water and cookies and things in preparation for that. It's what we get to do, okay, outside the walls. Also, don't forget, in your bulletin, the orphans from the father's house in the Ukraine, you got down to what, four?
We got one hosted this week.
Got one hosted this week. It's getting close, so if you can help out with that, let David know. All right, Wednesday night, youth, prayer meeting, Hebrews, children, coming. First November, we're giving Cedric some margin to finish out the children's area over there, get the staging built, the program built, the name, and first of November, it's open doors for children. All right? Let's stand. Yes, ma'am. The t-shirts, I'm going to hold off on to that time, make sure that I can get the proper thing to send to the printer.
Okay.
We are going to try to do t-shirts, so keep that in mind. They'll probably be between, probably about $8 a shirt for a good quality t-shirt. I want to make sure I can get that. Thank you. I asked you to fix the list, so right on. Thank you. Yes, sir.
Yeah, one other quick announcement. This Friday evening, the 11th, at 5:30, we're going to be having a time of fellowship at Dennis and Eileen Smith's house with Dennis and Eileen. And so if you can make it, be a good time. Those of you that were there last time, it was a real blessing. So if you can make it, this Friday, the 11th, 5:30 at Dennis and Eileen's.
Don't move. Stay right there. But again, Angelique and Tony, thank you all for driving over and leading to worship today. Great job.
He took that scary book. Yes.
There will be a meal provided.
Yeah, there's going to be a meal for you to have a good time of fellowship.
So just let either I or Patty know.
Okay.
So we know how many to plan.
All right. So contact Barbara or Patty so that we know how many will be there. Yesterday, I was on the internet. I was buying posters for the trunk of my car for Trunk or Treat. I'm going to be ready. And I saw a poster, and you know, whatever else was on the poster, it's not important. It's what the poster said. And I thought, you know, you could put a picture of Christ on there because this is what the poster said. It's not important where you go. It's who you go with. We're not, you know, we have a direction. We're headed there. We may not see the end just yet where we're going, but I hope as a church we know who we're going with. So, Heavenly Father, we thank you for the message this morning. And Father, we want to join our voices with Isaiah, that when the Lord called, he said, "Here am I, Lord, send me." Father, make us available. Give us hearts of unity. Give us, Father, that desire to love one another, Father, and to have that servant's heart that we need to truly pierce the community of Montverde for the gospel of Jesus Christ. Our goal, Father, is lives changed for eternity. In Jesus' precious name, amen.